I would like to start with a simple scheme that I operate in my mind to understand and to figure out how things work out in the contemporary political arena. I'm borrowing the square of Swaraj of Gandhi. I call it square of governance. And it requires four things to set up a nation state: a group of people, and a leader to lead these people towards the goal of prosperity and development. And the people and the state, nation state, cannot do all of this together without economy. And once you have all these three things in place, you are going for international communities' recognition and acceptance. We will leave this international community out of our purview for the time being, and we will focus only on these three things: the people, the state, and the economy. Now, the ideal thing would be the state should be working for the people, promoting their interests, like a good father or a good mother. But unfortunately, what's happening right now is the state is no longer working for the people of the nation state, it's working for the economic actors. They are given a lot more importance and preponderance in the whole scheme of things. People are often looked down upon as seditious, as anti-nationals, and against the development of our country. Gandhi called the state as a soulless machine, and it has come to be very true now. The state, nation state, is so important in today's world because the state provides, takes care of the survival of the people, the well-being of its citizens, identity, and freedom. The state is the preponderant authority that helps you, that secures, that makes sure that you are safe, you survive in this world. National security, financial security, energy security, and all the rest of it. And your well-being, the state provides the fundamental needs of you, takes care of your well-being. The national identity becomes the most important identity of all other identities. And our own very freedom is being safeguarded by the state. So state has become so important and powerful. Now the freedom of association and protest becomes very important in this kind of situation because the nation state is no longer working for us. It's working for the capitalist class, for the economy, for the economic actors, for local business houses, multinational corporations, and foreign countries. When the Manmohan Singh government came up with this nuclear policy, that's what we said: look, put the interests of our people ahead, not just the foreign interests of American corporations and Russian and French nuclear companies. In case of an accident like Fukushima, we are no position where we are in no way we can deal with such a disaster. So please work for us, not for the foreign corporations. And that was the reason why we were charged with sedition cases, waging war on the state, and all kinds of other dangerous cases. The liberalization, privatization, globalization scheme the state mindlessly follows takes care of the interests of the economic actors. Look at the interests of our workers. All their interests are being trampled upon by all kinds of legislations today. And you take the retail trade, crores of people in our country are making a living with retail trade all over the country. Now, when you let foreign direct investment come in this retail trade, all these mega marts and Kmarts and Walmarts are going to flood our country, and all these people are going to be helpless. They are going to be thrown into poverty and misery. We have 7,005 kilometer long coastline where the fisher people are engaging in sustainable fishing. They take care of their food security and are playing an important role in ensuring food security and nutrition security for all of us. People who live within the 50 kilometers from the coast rely completely on the seafood for our nutrition and food security. And the state doesn't really bother about any of that anymore. We need nuclear power plants, thermal power plants, shipwrecking plants, hotels, resorts, and all kinds of so-called development projects. And the fisher people are looked down upon as a nuisance. They are holding this important prime waterfront property. They should be kicked out of that so that India can develop. And that is the same situation with the farmers. Farmers are committing suicide, even in Tamil Nadu now. More than 120 people have killed themselves. It was all happening in Vidarbha, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, and we were not really very concerned about that. It has come to our shores, our doors now. Tamil farmers are killing themselves. We took a strong stand on this Kudankulam nuclear power plant, not because we are not interested in the development of our country, are not interested in the generation of electricity for the country, but we thought this is not in the best interest of our people. We are not prepared to face a calamity, a nuclear calamity. Our disaster preparedness itself is a disaster. And our government is so corrupt and inefficient. If Japan is struggling, reeling under this much pressure with the Fukushima accident, how on the earth are we going to deal with this issue, with the possible nuclear accident in our country? That's what we said. And the first two reactors in Kudankulam are not performing well at all. It's a complete failure. There are a lot of improprieties and problems. Even as we speak now, one of the reactors is shut down. And the other reactor has been shut down more than 36 times. A brand new nuclear power plant imported from Russia should not be shut down for 36 times. Why? So who is taking care of all these things? Who is negotiating with the terms of trade of all these nuclear reactors? Who is doing it? What will happen to all the spent fuel? Where are we going to store all these? And what will we do with the nuclear waste, which has to be protected for 48,000 years? And these are some of the simple questions that we asked. The state responded very authoritatively with such a high-handed manner. 380 cases were foisted on us. And when we approached the Supreme Court, the Supreme Court doesn't have the guts or intelligence to ask, why are sedition cases imposed on these simple people, fishermen? The court didn't ask a single question about sedition cases, waging war on the state. Instead, they asked the state and central governments to withdraw some of the cases, and they withdrew some 240 small cases, like they shouted against Manmohan Singh, they shouted against the Indian Union and all of that. We are still left with 140 cases, including 21 sedition cases and 21 waging war on the state. We are not Maoists, we are not Naxalites, we are not Tamil Tigers, we are not violent. Our struggle has been completely non-violent. We did not damage any public property or private property. We did not do any kind of interruption to the normal life of people either in Tamil Nadu or anywhere in the country. And why does the state have to come down so heavily on us? Passports were snatched away. People are denied passports even today. My own passport was snatched away almost 5 years ago. My bank accounts have been frozen, including my wife's. Hundreds of people are still struggling without the opportunity to go abroad to find a job. The state, the Indian state, adopted this 3I formula: ignore, insult, and intimidate. Ignore completely. No matter what you speak, no matter how you organize, we just ignore you. The state that has to be acting like a good father or mother is ignoring the people totally. Crying baby gets milk, we say that. Now, how does a baby cry? The diktat is, no, don't cry. We know what you want. We will tell you what to do and how to do. You just be quiet. And if the baby wants to cry, the baby has to make a petition to the mother. Mother, I am really hungry. Can I cry now? This is the city. You have to go. There was a time when you had to seek police permission, authorities permission only for public meetings. Now, even for organizing a hall meeting like this, you have to have permission. Not only from the local police authorities, even from the intelligence agencies. You have to go to the intelligence agencies and convince them that there is actually a need for such a protest or a program. So that authoritarian has authoritarian, that's how authoritarian it has become. Now, and once you cross a bridge that you cannot be ignored anymore, they start insulting you. They call you American stooge. They call you foreign funded. They say you are against the development of our country. You are conniving with foreign forces and thwarting the country's development and all that nonsense. And if you still persist and go ahead with the protest, then will come intimidation. Intimidation, police harassment, court proceedings, 35 cases have been charged sheeted against us, and we keep going back and forth to the courts, so you won't have time or energy to do anything else. So you just follow the dictate of the state and be there. So, there is no way you can prove that you are you are not anti-Indian or you are not anti-India's development. It becomes your onerous responsibility to prove your national credentials. Well, how do we resist these curbs? There are a lot of curbs. The media plays an important role in presenting you as an anti-national, anti-development person. And the state machinery is so strong that they can get away with anything that they do. And how do you curb a small group of people who have no political background or any kind of international or national support system? How on the earth are we going to defend ourselves? And that is why meetings like this, conversations, dialogue like this become so important. And that's one of the reasons why we always respect people like Wilfred and Anil Chaudhary and all, that you make this kind of dialogue possible. Otherwise, we are left on our own, battling our own little battles in our respective areas. So, how do you do? How do you curb these things? As the state becomes more and more fascistic, I think our spaces are becoming very limited and we are really at a loss how we go about this situation. I will stop with one example. Recently, the central government announced a project called Hydrocarbon Project. They said, we have identified 31 sites all over the country, discovered small fields. And the Indian government doesn't have the resources or the technology to tap all these resources from the ground. So we are handing over license to private parties. And these sites are widespread all over the country. They are not very profitable. So we are handing the licenses over to these 31 sites where the foreign or Indian public enterprises or mostly private companies can go and tap gases, petroleum and the coal, whatever is there in your allotted area. You can tap it for the next 15 years. You can fix the price. You can do whatever you want. Nobody is going to challenge you or ask you. The state will not interfere. One such site was the Pudukkottai district in Tamil Nadu. Just a month ago, all of a sudden, the state announced, okay, this is a hydrocarbon project And one of the sites is in Pudukkottai district. The people were completely, you know, shocked to hear this. That there are laws in this country. You have to organize a public hearing. You have to do an environmental impact assessment. Take the people into confidence. Tell them what it is all about. Have a democratic discussion and let the project affected people decide if they really want to have it or not. But none of that was happening. They just announced this is one of the sites. Not even a word of explanation. What the damn thing is hydrocarbon? How is this site chosen? Who chose it? And who gave this authority to you to grant this license to a company called Gem Laboratories from Karnataka, owned by a three-term BJP MP from Davangere constituency? Before him, his father, Mallikarjunappa, was the MP of the same constituency, Davangere. He was an RSS member, a prominent leader of the BJP. And then his son Chideswara became the MP for three times. And now his company, Gem Laboratories, is handed over the license to tap whatever he finds in Pudukkottai districts, which is a fertile area. I've been there several times. I was there 2 days ago. Very fertile land. People have been practicing farming for ages, from time immemorial. This particular area has been the food basket of the entire people of Tamil Nadu. And all of a sudden, that does not become important anymore. This tapping the hydrocarbons becomes the most important thing. And what do you think people should do? People have been up in arms, day in and day out, for weeks together. Poor women, men, youth, no negotiation takes place. No dialogue, no nothing. The state knows best what to do with all the resources. Yes, by all means, we need to tap the resources that lies beneath, but don't we have to eat? What the hell are we going to eat? Should food be our priority or what is lying inside? And should a private company benefit from all of that or lakhs of farmers who have been living and doing sustainable farming for ages? How do we define all this development and all of that? Now, the Tamil youth cannot take it anymore. The Jallikattu issue, as many of you, you know, are taking a very principled stand on this issue that this is a barbarian, anti-human and all of that. Now, I'm a lover of animals and I definitely don't support torturing or harassing any animal or human beings. But who are you? Who are you to decide what we should do in Tamil Nadu? We are not your slaves. We are not the slaves of Delhi elites. We are a sovereign people. We decide what is good and what is bad for us. It has to be an internal dialogue. You can obviously express your opinion as part of the Indian Union, the federal setup. It's not a federal setup now. It's all a completely colonizing Hindi imperialistic arrangement that we have. And that is why our youth took to the street and said, look, this cannot happen anymore. We cannot lie down taking all this. And ever since the Jallikattu struggle, people all over Tamil Nadu, men, women, youth, are protesting against the hydrocarbon project, nuclear power projects, huge expansion of nuclear power plants, and all kinds of so-called development projects. Now, all these protests have been completely non-violent. And they have been very respectful of women. Not even one untoward incident happened about women. No caste, no religious factors were ever held high. People were using a healthy degree of Tamil nationalism in all these struggles. And this is the only hope that people find in this dark age. If we cannot curb this state's high-handed impositions, diktats, obviously it will have a very disastrous impact on our very union. I, for one, am not very keen on seceding or separating, because like Donald Trump, we cannot go on building narrow domestic walls within the country and all over the world. We are one humanity. But that has to be based on mutual respect. And the state should not work for the economic actors, multinational corporations and foreign powers. The state has to work for our people. How do we facilitate this? There has to be horizontal mobilization. We cannot do it all by ourselves. It cannot happen just in Tamil Nadu or Orissa and other places. We have to do it all together. And how do we promote this dialogue? How do we promote this kind of horizontal mobilization is the most important thing, I think.